أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا وحبيب قلوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم محمد ثم الصلاة والسلام على آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المذلومين واللعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين من يوم عداوتهم إلى يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه وهو أصدق القائلين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ما أصاب من مصيبة في الأرض ولا في أنفسكم إلا في كتاب من قبل أن نبرأها إن ذلك على الله يسير لكي لا تعصوا على ما فاتكم ولا تفرحوا بما آتاكم والله لا يحب كل مختال فخور صلوات الله محمد Every human being, every intelligent, conscious human being, at some point in their lives, asks the question, what is the purpose of life? And this question comes to the forefront when humans encounter loss or suffering. For the longest of times, I held the opinion that every single human being has a unique purpose for which he or she is created on this earth. And this is an idea that many of you may also have or have had. It is fueled by many factors, including what we constantly hear in the media that says, go out and find your purpose in life, that you are your own unique individual human being who was created for a purpose. And we see a lot of slogans, a lot of posters, a lot of messaging in this vein to say you have a purpose and that your task in life for the first phase at least is to find this purpose in life. And so I've held this belief for a long time. And I have argued this view using Quran and Hadith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, in Surah Al-Mu'minun, which is chapter 23 of the Quran, verse 115, he says, أَفَحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ عَبَثًا Do you imagine, or do you suppose, or do you think that we created you in vain and without a purpose, just frivolously, abatha, wa annakum ilayna la turja'oon, and that you shall not return to us one day? So I have used this verse to argue that Allah Himself is saying, do you think I created you without a purpose? But then when I began to look around, what I found is that most humans leave this world without fulfilling any specific purpose. Most humans come to this world as children, grow up, go to school, go to university, find a job, find a spouse, get married, buy a home, have children of their own, work, just as animals rise every morning and go out foraging for food and then return to their watering holes in the evenings. We sit in traffic in the morning going looking for food and then sit in traffic again and come back home. But ask yourself, your parents, your grandparents, your uncles, your aunts, look around your community, your workplace, the people you know, the multitude of human beings. Do you think they all have a specific, unique purpose we may be able to identify a very great, unique purpose for specific individuals. If we speak of those who are infallible, we might say, for example, Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam was born for a special purpose. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. And that he had, you know, a mission for which he was born and created. Or if we speak of those who are not infallible, we might think of examples and say, you know, Ayatollah Khomeini, for example. But for the vast majority, including our own lives, we cannot speak of any glorious purpose. So this leaves us with a conundrum now. On one hand, Allah is saying, the proof that I am wise, that I am al-Hakim, is that I don't do anything without a purpose. And he is categorically saying, أَفَحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ عَبَثًا. Do you think I created you without a purpose? But on the other hand, the vast majority of humans don't seem to have a purpose. Does it mean that his objective, وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ, has failed? That is not possible. So as I began reflecting on this further, I came to a realization of where I misunderstood the verse. Yes, Allah is all-wise, and he created humans with a purpose. But that purpose is not individual. That purpose is collective. It is universal. There is one underlying primary purpose for which he created all of humanity, and by extension, all of creation. And this one purpose is so that the soul, which is the real you, not the physical shell that houses this soul, that this soul that comes into this world as an infant or in its raw form, that it may take shape and mature, that it may attain spiritual maturity. Just as we speak of physical maturity, that a child grows up and attains bulugh, or we speak of intellectual maturity, or we speak of emotional maturity, we speak of the soul's spiritual maturity. And this spiritual maturity manifests itself with a knowing and a realization of who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. The more spiritually mature a soul is, the more it is conscious of its creator and the less it is conscious of its own self. And by that measure, one can place every soul as to what level of maturity it has attained. And as I develop this, you will see that the underlying message here is that humanity is created in multitude, but all souls are undergoing a journey, a spiritual journey. And the end of the journey, which has no end, is to come to greater consciousness and awakening and realization of one's creator. It is not just a physical form of awakening. I will discuss this a little further and say, what do we mean by maturity or spiritual maturity, and what is it that we mean by knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The word maturity can mislead us. When I speak of spiritual maturity, we might assume that someone who has spent an extensive amount of time worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or someone who is intellectually and emotionally mature. There is some truth to this, and it all comes out in a mix. But when I speak of spiritual maturity, I'm not speaking purely in the physical, intellectual, or emotional sense. Why? There are many individuals who have attained a ripe old age, but when you interact with them, you realize that they have not really understood what religion is all about. They might pray a lot of salat, they might spend a lot of nights in ibadah, they might recite a lot of Quran, they might fast a lot of fasts, mustahab as well as, you know, the obligatory. But when you speak to them, you find that there is no depth and understanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or religion. You will find on one hand there is excessive dua and ibadah and salatul layl and fasting, But on the other hand, that same individual is filled with envy and jealousy and hatred and backbiting and lying. And you come to this realization that there is religiosity, but there is no spiritual maturity. Intellectual maturity, you might encounter an individual who has multiple PhDs, but he's an atheist. He doesn't believe in God. He is mature intellectually, but not spiritually in the sense that we speak. That is why when someone asked Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, what is intellect? What is aql? The Imam defined aql by saying, ma ubida bihir rahman wa ktusiba bihil jinan. Aql or intellect is that by which one comes to worship one's creator, and aql is that by which one earns one's place in paradise. Meaning, if you, with all your learnings and all your experiences, cannot come to the conclusion that I have a creator before whom I must bow, and you are not able to find a place in Jannah, then you have no aql, you have jahala. It doesn't matter how many PhDs you have pasted on the wall. So spiritual maturity is something else. When we speak of spiritual maturity, we speak of a submission to one's creator, where there is a diminishing of the egoic self and a greater awareness and consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and of knowing Him. So what we have said so far is that Allah is wise. He does not act without purpose. He created human beings for a purpose. The purpose is for these humans to mature, and that maturity manifests itself by them knowing Him. So now the question is, how do you know Allah, and what does it mean to know Allah? Knowing Allah is not through the mind or ratiocination or just using a mental process or activity to know Him, because He cannot be known that way. And the Quran, we cannot go into this in the interest of time, but you will find that the Quran is replete with examples where it speaks of the heart being blind and not the mind. Allah also mentions many places in the Quran about coming to Him and meeting Him or attaining proximity to Him. And by doing so, you get to know Him. The question is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not in a fixed location. So how do we come to know Him, and how do we come close to Him? Consider, for example, every act of worship. Islam requires us, it is a prerequisite, that any act of worship has to have an intention, and that intention has to be qurbatan ilallah. If it is not qurbatan ilallah, it is not accepted. It doesn't matter what it is, whether it is wudu, salat, hajj, even charity, anything you do, mustahab, wajib, if it is not qurbatan ilallah, it is rejected. What does qurbatan ilallah mean? Seeking nearness to Allah. How do you seek nearness to one who is already closer to you than your jugular vein? وَنَحْنُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ حَبْلِ الْوَرِيدِ. He is closer to you than whatever can be closest to you. How do you get closer to Him? Therefore, qurbatan ilallah is not a movement in time or space, but qurbatan ilallah is a movement in consciousness and awareness and knowing Allah. In Surah Al-Inshiqaq, He says, Ya ayyuhal insan, innaka kadihun ila rabbika kadhan famulaqih. O human being, you are constantly toiling and struggling. You're not conscious of it, but you are. You are constantly toiling and struggling towards your sustainer with a severe toiling. And you will meet Him. فَمُلَاقِيهِ. How does this liqa Allah happen? In Surah Al-Kahf, He says, فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ اللَّهِ. So whoever hopes to meet Allah, to have this meeting with Allah, فليعمل عملا صالحا ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أحدا. Then let him act righteously and not associate anyone in the worship of his Lord. Whoever hopes to meet, to have this liqa Allah, how does this happen? Inna lillah, we belong to Allah. Wa inna ilayhi raji'un, and to him we are constantly returning. How are you returning to him when he's already with you? You are returning to him, meaning you are attaining greater consciousness of him. The greatest liqa, kaaba qawsaini aw adna, when you come absolutely close to Allah, is not a physical meeting. It is a complete suspension of the egoic self and a full view of the radiance and full magnificence of the one and only reality that is our creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is coming to this full consciousness. Istajibu lillahi wa lirrasul idha da'akum lima yuhyikum. Answer the call and invitation of Allah and His Messenger when they invite you to that which will give you life. That means you are not alive right now. You are asleep. You are unconscious. When you attain full consciousness, that is when you come to life. That is when you wake up. An-nasu niyamun. Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi says, people are asleep. They are in this world. They're producing children, going to work, eating, sleeping. But it's like they're on a stretcher. They're being carried. They're asleep. An-nasu niyamun. Idha matu intabahu. When they die, they wake up. Why? Because when you die, the egoic self collapses. That sense of I, that false sense of I that your mind produced when you were born, it forcefully is snatched from you. What is painful about death is not the physical pain. It is losing that sense of I. So when you lose that, that's when you wake up and you realize there is only one reality and it is so beautiful. So the purpose of life, when we say the purpose of life is to know him and for the soul to mature, we mean it is to attain a state where we bask in the love of Allah, where we drown in his love, where instead of being this small egoic self that feels suffering is real and says, why did Allah create me and I suffer so much? We feel the warmth and tremendous love of a magnificent Lord, and we feel this deep sense of indebtedness and humility that he created us that we may feel this presence and love. That is why you see a mystic never asks, why did Allah create me? And now I suffer. Even this famous hadith, you know, the hadith of Kanzul Makhfiyah, when we say, why did Allah create anything? And we say, Allah says, I was a hidden treasure. Hadith al-Qudsi, right? Kuntu Kanzam Makhfiyah. I was a hidden treasure and I wanted to be known. So I created a creation, لِكَيْ أُعَرَفْ, so that I may be known. Then we ask this question from our small egoic minds, why does Allah want to be known? He doesn't need anyone to know him. He doesn't need fame. Was he bored? Was he lonely? Why did he create us so that we could know him? No, my dear brothers and sisters. He created a creation so that he may be known is also a giving of his grace and love. It is his lutf. He wants to be known so that you can benefit from that and experience the love of knowing him. The more you know him, the more conscious you become of him, the greater you feel his presence, and everything else then falls away in terms of what we define as physical suffering. And so there is a brilliant radiance that exudes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The most primary attribute that radiates from Allah is his love, his mahabbah, his rahmah, his lutf. And that is why we are told, sabaqat rahmatuhu ghadaba. His mercy overwhelms his wrath. His aim in creation, in creating creation, is to bring everyone to know him. And that is why he wants everyone to succeed. And every soul is on a journey towards knowing him.
If you can recite a salat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So every incident that we experience in life, good or bad, is an opportunity for us to build certain traits in our souls that will help the soul to mature to a point where it willingly surrenders itself and experiences consciousness of God. Traits such as patience, courage, humility, selflessness. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in one place in Surah Al-Baqarah, He says, Ista'inu bisabri wassalat. Seek help with patience and with prayer. Inna Allaha ma'as-sabirin. Allah is with those who are patient. And elsewhere in Surah Al-Baqarah, He says, Wasta'inu bisabri wassalat. Seek help with patience and prayer. Wa innaha lakabiratun illa 'alal khashi'in. But this is very difficult to do, except on those who are humble. Because those who are humble are less egoic. It is they who will want patience and who will constantly turn to Allah and pray towards Him for this help. Patience is a primary attribute and trait of the soul that we need to strive for in order to build that maturity that will bring us to consciousness of God. When you look at this holistically in the Quran, you will find it is the single most important trait in a human soul. When the people of Jannah, of paradise, entered paradise, they are ushered in and they are welcomed by the angels. And the angels tell them, Salamun alaykum, peace be on you, as they enter Jannah. This is their abode where they shall live for all eternity. Salamun alaykum, peace be on you. Why? Because you prayed a lot of salat on the earth? No. Because you fasted a lot? No. Because you gave a lot of wealth in charity? No. Because you went for a lot of hajj and ziyarah? No. Salamun alaykum bima sabartum. Peace be on you because of the sabr you had when you were in the world. Fani'ma uqbad dar. So how excellent is this eternal abode for you today? In other words, they are saying to them, peace be on you. Your patience has led you to a level of maturity where you are now so conscious of God that you can live for all eternity in bliss. Bima sabartum, fani'ma uqbad dar. So, in summarizing this, and I'm running out of time here, Allah is all wise. He does not act without purpose. He created humans for a purpose. The purpose was for humans to know Him. In order to know Him, the soul needs to attain maturity. This knowing does not happen with the mind, but it happens through consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and knowing Him, feeling His presence and being fully conscious of Him, which leads us to submission. And this explains why Allah did not simply create us and plant us in Jannah. Because we need to have those interactions in this world that help us to build the attributes that help us to have these realizations and maturity that bring us to these levels of consciousness. Now, how do we build these traits? We build these traits in ourselves through one thing, and that one thing is suffering. Suffering happens in two ways. One way that suffering happens is through Sharia. Sharia imposes certain things on us in a very gentle manner, expose us to some hardship that build these traits in us. For example, Sharia tells us to wake up at dawn and pray Salatul Fajr. When we get up at that morning, we struggle against our souls, and in doing so, we build certain attributes and qualities that will help us to attain that God consciousness. Fasting, now that we are at the doorstep of the month of Ramadan, fasting has been prescribed for you as it was prescribed for those before you. Why? لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. So that you may attain taqwa. What is taqwa? Taqwa is God consciousness. It brings us back to the same thing, that fasting also is to help you to become more conscious of Allah. Parting with your wealth is a hardship. Going for jihad is a hardship. These are all different forms of sharia that give you some form of suffering but help nurturing the soul. The other way in which we encounter suffering is when we have to deal with other souls that are less mature than we are at our level. They may be our family members, parents, children, siblings, relatives, or they may be friends or people at work. as we encounter and deal with them, opportunities arise for us to build these qualities in our souls. We can choose to be patient or impatient. We can choose to be selfless or selfish. We can choose to be arrogant and angry or be humble. So we can choose to be courageous or we can be cowardly. There are constant challenges, from the person who annoys you in the traffic jam, to the person at work, to the person who says something hurtful at home. There is constant challenges, but that is why Islam does not permit you to go live in a cave or be a monk living in a monastery. Islam wants you to live in society, because that is where the soul is forged, in the fire of suffering and tribulation, where it attains these qualities. Ask yourself, when do we become patient? When we have to hold ourselves back from something we want or something we have lost? When do we have to be selfless? When we have to prefer something for others over ourselves? When do we need to be humble? When we are angry and when there is an opportunity to be arrogant? When do we need to have courage? When there is something that we fear but we have to do? Supposing these challenges did not come in our lives, then how would we become patient? How would we be courageous? How would we become selfless? We would all die arrogant, selfish, ignorant, cowards who are impatient. The opportunity for these qualities would never arise without having this. And that is why the Quran repeatedly says this. Kutiba alaykum al-qital. Fighting has been prescribed for you, where you may have to give your life. Wa huwa kurhun lakum. Even though we know that you don't like it, you hate it. Wa asa an takrahu shay'an. Wa huwa khayrun lakum. It may be that you despise something in life, but it is good for you. Wa asa an tuhibbu shay'an. Wa huwa sharrun lakum. And it may be that you love something, but it is good for you. Wallahu ya'lamu wa antum la ta'lamun. Allah knows, you don't know. Meaning Allah's eyes is on your soul, on your journey to Him. He wants your soul to mature and come to a fruition and bloom and blossom so that you know Him. And the way to that is through suffering. You are looking at your physical dimension and your animal instinct and running away from suffering, and therefore missing the whole purpose of life. And so the verses of the Quran that I began with, in which Allah says, no affliction befalls you in this world, on this earth, or in yourselves, but it is in a book recorded before we send it down to you. That means any suffering that befalls you is not out of our control. We regulate and we control it and we know what befalls you. And inna dhalika ala Allahi yaseer. This is very easy for Allah to do. Why does He let you suffer? لِكَيْ لَا تَعْسَوْ عَلَى مَا فَاتَكُمْ وَلَا تَفْرَحُ بِمَا آتَاكُمْ. So that you do not become a creature that is always despairing and depressed and despondent when something bad befalls you, and a creature that gloats and becomes arrogant and overly rejoicing and happy when something physically good comes to you. We want to regulate and mature your soul so that you are not constantly swinging like a pendulum from one side to the other of overjoy and despair. And that is why we constantly send you suffering, so that you may mature in your soul and in your understanding. Now, here then we must ask the question, why do the prophets of Allah suffer then? And I'm trying to move as fast as I can in the interest of time. The first reason they suffer is because when they come to this world, they encounter souls that are immature, such as ours. People like you and I cause them hardship. The second reason is that even they grow in their knowledge of Allah when they encounter suffering. Now, you might be surprised to hear that, because our belief is that they are perfect beings, the prophets and the imams, alayhi salam. But if you look at the du'as of the imams as well, when they glorify Allah, they say to Allah, لا يعلمه إلا هو. No one knows Him except Him. Allah's knowledge of Himself is infinite, and no one knows His essence except Himself. We read in the Quran, for example, the story of Musa and Khidr alayhi salam, when they go on a journey. Musa becomes a student and learns from Khidr, and he is a prophet, a ma'asum, an ulul azm prophet. We have a hadith from our imams alayhi salam that say that every Thursday night we receive new knowledge from Allah that elevates our status and increases in our ma'rifah of Allah. We are told that when Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam was leaving Medina and he went to the grave of the prophet, and his eyes closed for a moment, and he had a vision. He cried to the Prophet and said to him, that Ya Rasulullah, pray to Allah to take my soul now so that I am not separated from you. What did Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam say to Imam al-Husayn? He said, Ya Husayn, you must go to Karbala. Why? Ya Husayn, inna laka darajatun indallahi la tanaluhu illa bishahada. Oh Husayn, you have a status with Allah that you will not be able to attain unless you attain martyrdom. So even an imam has a certain rank and a level. And there are other ahadith as well that would argue this point, but in the interest of time as well, I leave them here. So just as we might conceive an expanding universe that never ends, the journey towards knowing Allah also never ends because Allah is infinite. And even when we go to Jannah, inshallah, it continues, and that is the source of the pleasure of Jannah as well. It never ends. But suffering is an integral part of it. Or as someone put it very beautifully, light enters you through the very wounds from which you bleed. We must come to this point where we accept that suffering is important and necessary to us in our life. Now, if that is the question, then we must change our perspective. When our daughter gets married, we grieve. When our parent or child or sibling passes away, we grieve. When we lose wealth, we grieve. When our health is lost, we grieve. We look at things as black and white, isn't it? Someone murders someone, the murderer is bad, the victim is the poor soul who lost his life. But for a moment, supposing that loss of health or wealth or loved one was a means through which it accelerated the maturity of our soul and brought us to greater consciousness of God and thereby helped us fulfill the purpose of life, is it still bad? Or is it a conditioning of our minds? So I have come to a conclusion, and I want to just answer two questions very quickly, and then inshallah come to masaib and end. The first question is, if suffering is good, then why should we not pray to Allah to give us pain and suffering, or invite suffering and affliction to ourselves? And the second question is that if suffering is such a great thing, then why do we cry for Imam al-Husayn and for the other imams by extension? Allah has given us a physical body as well that must survive on this earth. And this body is driven by animal instinct, or what we call a tabi'a. It is unnatural for us to want suffering to this physical body. Suffering is good for the soul, but it is not good for the body. So there is a sense of tension and clash between the two. And Allah therefore puts it very beautifully to us and says, you work towards well-being, towards knowledge, towards wealth, towards health, and ask me for it. But my aim is for your soul to mature. And wherever it is necessary, in order for you to fulfill the purpose of your life, I will bring suffering on your course. And your attitude and your reaction to that suffering and how you behave at that point will forge your soul and give it the maturity it needs to come to be full conscious of me. In other words, it is the clash between your physical instinct to want comfort and survival and your soul's need for suffering that brings together this opportunity for the soul to bloom. Just as a butterfly, when it is in its cocoon as a worm, it only becomes a butterfly and forms its wings when it struggles and pushes against the forces that hold it down. And as I have mentioned in a previous lecture, if you take a blade and split that cocoon and let the worm out, the wings will never form. It will never become that beautiful butterfly. So that struggle as well has a message. But what is important is that when we struggle, we don't do it with despair, with despondency, with the sense that I am on my own, that Allah is not aware of my pain and suffering, that He is not watching. But rather we do it with courage and with full cognizance that this is an important ingredient for my soul and that I will not perfect myself by going around the fire, but rather by swimming through it and in its depths. For ore only becomes gold when it burns at very high temperatures in the fire. As far as Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam is concerned, the reason we cry for him is not because of his physical suffering only. It is not a historic event that we cry for, but rather that the Battle of Karbala is a living history that is with us even today, that Karbala happens today as well. We cry for him because he is the proof of Allah on the earth. We cry for him because of what he represents to Allah and to humanity. A lot of people might compare his physical suffering to some great tragedy of another human being. But ask yourself, a lot of human beings who suffer tragedy, they are thrown into it and they have no way to get out of it. They don't choose that suffering. Imam Hussein had a choice to save his life at every step of the way. But he chose to go through that for the sake of rescuing humanity. And one great mystic in Islam, in Shia Islam, Sayyid ibn Tawus, he says, if we knew what levels Imam al-Hussein and the Shuhada of Karbala attained on the day of Ashura, he says, we would celebrate it like a day of Eid. وَلَلَبَسْنَا لِبَاسَ الْفَرْحِ And we would dress in adornments and clothes of Eid. It doesn't mean that we do that. But from a spiritual dimension, there is something very great that happened with the sacrifice of al-Hussein alayhi salam. And that is why you see that the Quran says for other human beings, فَمَا بَقَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا كَانُوا مِنَ الْمُنْذَرِينَ The heavens and the earth did not weep for them, nor were they given any respite. For Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, the heavens and the earth wept as well. We have this documented in the books of ahadith of Shia and Sunni, that on the day that Imam al-Hussein was mercilessly slaughtered in the plains of Karbala, it rained blood from the heavens. The angels wept for him. The earth quaked. The sun was eclipsed. Why? Because of the violence with which the proof of Allah was killed and his blood was spilled on the earth. And it is for this reason that you see that the message from Imam al-Sajjad and Sayyidah Zainab after Karbala as well is constantly to remind people that the person who has been killed is not an ordinary human being. In the bazaars of Kufa, we see that when the soldiers were carrying the heads of Imam al-Hussein and the other shuhada on spears, and they were proudly announcing and bragging at the fact that we have killed a rebel, wal-iyadu billah, and we have killed so-and-so, Zainab alayhi salam was calling out from behind and saying, O people, do not say this, but rather say, you have killed the grandson of Rasulullah. O people, do not say, but rather say, you have killed one for whom angels wept in the heavens. O people, say, you have killed one whose cradle was rocked by Jibra'il. O people, say, you have killed the son of Zahra, alayhi salam. When this qafila continued through the bazaar of Kufa, they came to an alleyway in which there was a lady who had once served the Ahlul Bayt, alayhi salam. Habiba was sitting in her house reading the Quran when this qafila was passed through the bazaars below her home. Her kaniz, her maid servant, came to her and said to her, Bibi, there is some asir, there are some prisoners who have been brought out to the streets of Kufa. You should come out and look at them. Habiba said to her maid servant, I will not do that. Why? Because my Shehzadi Zainab told me once in Medina, never go out and look at the tamasha of the asir. But this maid servant went away. She came back again in a little bit and said, Habiba, this is not an ordinary qafila. There is noor from their faces. You must come out and look at them. Oh, Habiba, there are little children in this qafila who are calling out, Al-Atash, Al-Atash. Perhaps you may come out and serve them. But Habiba left her home and came down. She brought a pitcher of water and she brought some dates with her. She stopped by a camel on which was Sayyida Zainab, and on her lap was a four-year-old daughter of Al-Hussein. Habiba came close to the child. She said to the child, my child, you look very thirsty. I have brought some dates and water for you. But I have heard a respected Sayyid report this riwayah. He says what he read in this riwayah is that when Sakina saw the dates and she realized how hungry and thirsty she was, she looked at Habiba and first asked her a question, Bibi, these dates are not sadaqah, are they? Are these dates sadaqah? When Habiba assured Sakina that this is not sadaqah, she took the dates in her hand. Then Habiba said to her, my child, when you have had the water and the dates, I want you to recite a dua for me. I want you to say a prayer for me. But Zainab stopped Sakina for a moment. My child,
recite her dua first and then quench your thirst. But Sakina raised her trembling little arms. She raised her little hands towards the heaven and waited for Habiba to ask for her wishes. Habiba said to Sakina, "My child, pray for my children that they do not become asir and yatim as you have become." But Sakina, I do not know how, she raised her arms. "Oh Allah, let not her children become yatim as I have become yatim. Oh Allah, do not let her children become asir and prisoners as we have become prisoners." Then Habiba said to her, "My child, pray for me that I may also be blessed with the ziyarah of Medina." But when Zainab heard the name of Medina, she said to her, "Tell me, O lady, what have you to do with Medina?" She said, "My Aqa Hussein is in Medina. My Shehzadi Zainab is in Medina. I long for their ziyarah." Zainab said to her, "O Habiba, if you see your Shehzadi Zainab, will you recognize her?" "Yes, I will recognize her. I served in their home." But Zainab parted her hair. "Habiba, there is the head of Hussein on a spear if you wish to do salam." "O Habiba, I am the Zainab whose ziyarah you long for."
ألا لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. إلهي بحق محمد وأنت المحمود وبحق علي وأنت الأعلى وبحق فاطمة وأنت فاطر السماوات والأرض وبحق الحسن وأنت المحسن وبحق الحسين وأنت قديم الإحسان وبحق تسعة المعصومين من ذرية الحسن والحسين. يا الله يا الله يا الله يا الله. We ask you, Allah, on this Thursday night to accept our gathering here and to forgive all our sins. Ilahi bihaqi Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, we ask you for shifa of those who are ill and maghfira for those who have passed away. Ilahi bihaqi Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, we ask you for ta'ajil in the dhuhur of our imam. Ilahi bihaqi Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, we ask you for health in this coming month of Ramadan. We ask you, Allah, to give us the courage to spend its nights in ibadah and its days in your dhikr and in fasting. Ilahi bihaqi Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, we ask you to bless us with greater awareness and taqwa that we may come to you with consciousness and for the purpose for which you created us. Rabbana taqabbal minna innaka antas sami'ul alim. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.